one of the most intriguing, well-known, and initial approaches to psychology in history and in popular culture has been psychoanalysis and the psychodynamic approach. Basically, what psychoanalysis is and what it revolves around are theories created in the late 1800s and early 1900s by a psychologist by the name of Sigmund Freud. And really, what they apply to and what they are based off of are principles that are relevant to the idea that the unconscious or underlying thoughts, desires, drives, feelings, and cognitions determine and influence our conscious, or the part of our mind, the thoughts, the feelings, the emotions, the cognitions that we are aware of. Now, psychoanalysis, before we really get into the specifics of it, is a very controversial idea, a very controversial psychological approach that some still believe in, that has produced many useful, impactful, and even still today accepted theories and beliefs, but as a whole has largely been dismissed by the scientific psychological community because of the fact that, to the unfortunate reality of many, it cannot be exactly tested or proved through the scientific method, as is not able to be fully observed. And we'll get into specifically why that is in a moment. But first, let's get straight into it, understand what exactly it is and what its components are. Psychoanalysis is, as I said before, the idea that the unconscious mind influences the conscious mind, and that some of the actions, behaviors, thoughts, and desires that we consciously understand and are aware of are to a degree influenced by certain factors, whether having it occurred in our youth through stages of development, which I'm going to get to in a second, or whether it be something that we currently have, a drive that we currently have, those factors influence our current conscious experience. So to understand what all this means, in layman's terms, from a basic perspective, we have to understand what exactly all those terms mean. So Sigmund Freud, really the founder of psychoanalysis, believed that there were three layers of the psyche, or the part of the mind that involves perception, thought, and awareness. And there are three layers. The first layer, the top layer, is called the conscious mind. And it's the mind that we are aware of, the thoughts, emotions, and feelings that we consciously experience, that we currently experience, that we understand, that we know, and that we have control over. Then there is our preconscious mind, which is really our some thoughts, knowledge, memories, series of events, skills, and other things that are not currently being thought about, but that at any time, if we need them, we know they exist and we can basically take them and utilize them at particular moments. And then, of course, there is the unconscious mind, which is the underlying portion of the mind in which the underlying, perhaps suppressed or repressed, desires, feelings, and thoughts abide, and that we don't have control or are aware of, in theory. Now, to understand how these apply in our actions, our behaviors, and our thoughts, we have to analyze a theory proposed by Freud called the theory of the superego. And basically, the reason why it's relevant is because it explains why in society we are conscious of certain thoughts and feelings, and why we are not of others, and moreover, why we behave in certain ways, and why we suppress other behaviors that we may want or feel, but that we don't exhibit. And the way we understand this is through the principle of the superego. So basically, there are three layers of our behavioral monitoring. That's a way to put it. There is the id, the ego, and the superego. The id is basically our unconscious thoughts, desires, and drives. Basically, things that we want to do, or that we feel like we really need to do, that are constantly being pushed. In the id, what our basic feelings are, whether it be drives like hunger, sexual desire, fear, the desire to acquiesce or attain something, or any other basic feeling, emotion, perhaps even a primitive feeling or emotion, those exist and are constantly being pushed by the id. Then there's the superego, which exists in our conscious mind, which is the it's almost our moral framework. It's the ideas, notions, and concepts that have been taught to us by society. It's really our moral and ethical compass, our sense of right and wrong. And what the superego tends to do is it tends to explain to the id, in a way, why we can't just constantly exhibit our desires. The reason why, for instance, let's say, well, first let me explain what the ego is, the last one, I almost forgot. The ego is basically the mediator between the superego and the id. The ego is the middleman, the middle ground, that seeks to determine, well, which one should I obey, which one should I lean to, my moralistic superego or my underlying and highly driven id. So let's do an example. So let's say that you're really hungry. You haven't eaten in since the morning, and it's now 7 o'clock at night, and you're dying for some food. Now, let's say that you're maybe on the outskirts of a road, and you see this man, kind of an old, decrepit, not very strong, kind of crouching, visibly, noticeably weak, older man. And he hasn't even taken a bite out of it yet, but he has this beautiful, pristine cheeseburger that you've been craving for months now. The one that you've been trying to find but couldn't quite put your finger on. And let's say you're starving, you know the nearest restaurant isn't for a while, and you desperately want. Your id is immediately flashing on, and it's saying, go on, take it, just take it. He's a feeble old man. He doesn't pose a threat to you. There's no one who's going to see you. You're not going to get caught. Just take the burger from him and eat it. You know you want it. That's what the id would say. Now, the superego would come in then promptly and say, well, hold up. Wait a minute. You know it's wrong. You know what your mom and dad and what society and school has taught you. Stealing is horrible. It destabilizes society. You know, you might get caught. I mean, why would you? He's a feeble old man. You know there's a store here. You have the money. Don't be stupid. Don't break the law. Don't violate your basic moral principles and violate this man's liberty. Take away his food. That's not right. That's not just. Why do that? Now, the ego is really the man himself kind of deciding, perhaps even unconsciously, which one to choose. Is it, should I go more towards my superego? Or should I go more towards my id? Which one should I obey? Now, really, the ego, in certain circumstances, may lean towards one over the other, but typically it tends to find a middle ground. So, for instance, in that scenario, the ego would probably say, well, you know what? I have the money. You know, I'm really hungry. What I'll do is I'll go to the store, and I'll drive out a few miles out of town. I'm going to go try to get that nice burger. I'll see if I can find it. Now, if let's say he can't find it and he's trying to get some, his id might eventually kick in, and he might get really frustrated, might start yelling at a store clerk if they don't have the cheeseburger that he wanted, he might honk at cars if there's traffic on the way to the store, and many other principles. But at the end of the day, the way that our minds work in the psychodynamic perspective is that there is almost a mediation between our desires and what is practical. Now, in Freudian psychology, one of the most controversial elements of his ideas were the psychosexual stages. And while contrary to their view, they don't really have much to do in principle with the actual act of libido or of sex. What they really are relevant to is our development psychologically in conjunction with our physicality, and how our environment and our internal needs and growth also impacts and nurtures our psychological growth. And really, I'm not going to go into all the specifics of psychosexual stages because they're very controversial. Many, they're very graphic in some cases. You know, many psychologists have completely debunked them. Even many psychoanalysts today and many Freud lovers today acknowledge that much of the psychosexual stages were flawed. But nonetheless, it's important to understand them notionally and understand their impact on modern psychology. And what they were is that involved five stages. That's the oral stage, the anal stage, the phallic stage, the latency stage, and the genital stage. And really, what the oral stage is as it sounds, the idea that as a young infant begins to explore the world with their mouths, as they begin to kind of suck on things, put their fingers in their mouth, put objects in their mouth, other ways of trying to explore the world through the one sense they have really developed, which is their taste, they begin to exhibit the world in that way. They can feel things with their mouths, they can move things. And what Freud argued is that if you don't ever mature out of the oral phase, you begin to, as an adult or as a more developed man, you might do things like smoke cigarettes, bite your nails, suck your thumb, and do things with your mouth because you feel that you don't have as control of it. You don't really have so much control amongst your environment, so you have to utilize other things through that basic sense. Next, there's the anal stage, which revolves on the idea that at this stage, young toddlers begin to exert control over their bowels, over their muscles, over their bladder, over their coordination, and many things that begin to exhibit forms of not only physical self-control, but in Freud's view, psychological self-control. And people who either, there are two possible people in this scenario. There are people who don't progress from it, who get stuck in that stage, who never gained a full control of themselves physically and psychologically. And so when it comes to interactions with the natural environment, they tend to be very messy, disorganized. They might have anger bursts. They can't really control their anger or their sadness or their fear or their emotion. They might be very type B. You know, a lot of personality characteristics that revolve around a less developed, less neurotic, less organized person. Now, on the contrary, if Freud argued that if you're too developed in this stage, you can become, as the famous coined term which comes from this stage, you can be very anal or neurotic. You can be extremely focused on trying to be very immaculate, meticulous, organized, with a file for every little folder, for every little thing. You can be very OCD. You can have to organize chairs in specific places, have to move place settings. You can be very very focused on trying to eliminate germs or dirt almost to an insane degree, and many other consequences that Freud argued can be the result of overdevelopment in this stage. Next, there's the phallic stage, which really revolves around Freud's principles of Oedipus and Electra, which, contrary to much public opinion and popular cultural representation of this theory, doesn't really so much revolve around the idea of wanting romantic intimacy with your parent of the opposite sex. It's more of developing a special bond or attachment or almost proximity towards a parent of the opposite gender, because now you understand that you have two sets of parents who maybe have different physicalities, different styles, different emotions, and you seek to gain an attachment with the one of the opposite emotions, because it's a new, different perspective for you that can keep you protected from a perspective you don't understand. So that's why oftentimes people, according to Freud, or in this Oedipus and Electra complex, Oedipus for boys, Electra for girls, in his view, is that boys tend to be, gain a very close attachment to their mother or their mommy, and they tend to almost be into some degree in competition with their fathers over their mother, and vice versa for girls. And the reason why he thought this is because basically children at that stage can't determine that mommy loves daddy in a different way that mommy loves the son or daughter. They view love and attachment as a one singular concept, and they can't view it from a complex, distinct analytical perspective. Next, there's the latency stage, where basically in this time, two things can happen. One, the person can push back their thoughts and their desires and their almost emotional, psychological, motivational growth to the side, and focus more on societal, social things and needs, like the acquisition of knowledge, of gaining friendships, learning how the world works, you know, experimenting with things, basically kind of pushing aside your desires and drives. Now, the opposite can also be the case. Some people can focus purely on rebellion and focus on trying to fully understand their drives and desires in the context of their newfound society and social life. Now, finally, there's the final stage in Freud's psychosexual stages, which is the genital stage, which, contrary to its term, doesn't necessarily apply to male or female private parts. What really it refers to is the creation of interpersonal social relationships and now trying to commit yourself and your development to others by engaging in, let's say, marriage or a close relationship or starting a family or other things in which, now that you've developed personally, you want to now engage in that growth of others. Now, these stages are highly controversial. Really, they haven't been scientifically observed or proven in any way because they can't. They're really just philosophical. You can't do an experiment testing cognition and thoughts that are that you're unaware of, as Freud admittedly stated. And so, because of new forms of cognitive development, like Piaget's cognitive stages of development, or Erikson's identity crisis, and many more theories of how young children and eventually adults develop over time, much of Freudian psychosexual development has been cast aside, even by psychoanalysts themselves. Now, one of the last very critical aspects of psychodynamics and psychoanalysis were the creation of the defense mechanisms, which are still very much observed, analyzed, and can be scientifically tested today. What they revolve around are basically a handful of psychological mechanisms that people use to make sure that they feel protected and secure from potential attacks on their psyche. So examples of this include intellectualization, in which, let's say, you're trying to buy, let's go to a different example. Let's say that you're really nervous about a math test and you feel that you didn't do well on a math test. And basically, you're going to intellectualize, you're going to analyze, well, my GPA is already a 3.70, so if I get an F on this math test or a D on it, I can still get N with an A. You're going to try and almost substantively justify why you're performing a certain action. Then there's rationalization, in which you try and directly justify more socially a particular behavior. So, for example, if you're eating ice cream and you're worried that, you know, you're not eating as healthy, you might say, oh, well, you know what, I'm going to eat ice cream now, but tomorrow I'm going to work out all day, so it's going to be fine. You're justifying your current behavior through rationalization. Then, of course, there's the most notable, denial, in which one completely denies that there's any problem or circumstance going on. So if, let's say, they're engaging in a kind of an annoying noise habit, denial may be, oh, no, I'm not doing that. There's no way I do that. I'm not that kind of person. You know, people have complimented me in the past for the fact that I've been so quiet and considerate of other people's, noise complaints. There's no way I'm doing that. That's just all in their heads. Now, there are other examples, including projection, in which someone may transfer their own feelings on and their own anger on a particular person or subject to something else. Like, for instance, if you're mad at, let's say if a dad is mad at his boss because his boss didn't give him his long-determined pay raise, he might yell at his kids because that's his projection, because he's been stimulated, let's say, in some capacity by the regular activities and habits of his kids. Now, two other important ones are transference, which is the idea that people may transfer their own views and their own ideas to other people. So, for instance, if you're attracted to someone else and you're dealing with problems with not being able to get that person to reciprocate your attraction, you may create attraction for someone else because you feel like someone in authority, because you feel that you're almost transferring your attraction to someone you can control, someone you could possibly get. And then, of course, there's another very critical defense mechanism called formation reaction. And the idea of formation reaction is that basically people might actually exhibit the opposite thought or behavior than of what they're feeling towards someone else or something else. So for example, the most classic example of formation reaction. Let's say you're really attracted to someone, but you're worried that they won't like you back. Sometimes formation reaction will step in and you'll actually manufacture hatred, animus, or dislike for that person from like a personality standpoint or a physical standpoint or another characteristic because of the fact that you fear that they're not going to reciprocate your attraction. So you try to alienate yourself from them by manufacturing things you dislike about them. Now, all these concepts are relevant to the core structure of psychoanalysis and one initial perspective, one of the first major functionalist perspectives of psychology, and they are extremely impactful to understanding the evolution of modern psychology. But it's important to keep in mind this is only one theory, much of which has been cast aside by the modern scientific community and many other scientific and psychological approaches, which I'll explain in other segments. And it's also important to understand that this is just the very bare bones of psychoanalysis. There's so much more to it, so many different theorists, so many different applications that I didn't have the time to bring up. So it's important for you to do your own research and understanding how everything works out and why things are the way they are with regards to this subject and, of course, all areas of academia.